Well, good morning, everyone, and a very hearty and warm welcome to our morning service here in Cumber Free Presbyterian Church. We're delighted to see you, both upstairs and down, and we're thankful to the Lord that there are folks still coming after the 3 weeks you have put in and the effort you have made, and we do appreciate that. But we just want to warmly welcome you all in the Saviour's name, and we're glad to see you. It's good to see our sister Margaret Alexander back out again and on the road to recovery. And Desmond, we trust the Lord will continue his hand upon those who haven't been well and others who are still in hospital. Also to those that are listening on the live stream, again, we warmly welcome you and your family, and we want to thank you for your continued support and your encouragement, even by way of email and text message and phone calls. And we trust that the Lord will draw near, and whatever your need is today, he will indeed meet you at the point of your need. So we're glad to see you all. We warmly welcome you in our Saviour's precious name. Before we sing, I want you to turn to Psalm number 98 in your Bible. The 98th Psalm. Doesn't give the author, just simply says a psalm or a song or a hymn. We always believe that those psalms that don't contain the name of the author mostly are attributed to David. And while we don't have as some other psalms across there, Psalm 101, the Psalm of David, etc., but a psalm, and we do believe that David most likely is the author of the 98th psalm. We'll just read a few verses together, for we have had a blessed time, and we want just to lift the word of God in thanksgiving and praise and remember the goodness of the Lord. Psalm 98 then, verse 1, O sing unto the Lord a new song. For he hath done marvellous things. His right hand and his holy arm hath gotten him the victory. The Lord hath made known his salvation. His righteousness hath he openly showed in the sight of the heathen. He hath remembered his mercy and his truth toward the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. Make a loud noise and rejoice and sing praise. Sing unto the Lord with the harp and the voice of a psalm, with trumpets and sound of cornet. Make a joyful noise before the Lord, the King. Amen. The Lord will bless even this reading to all of our hearts. We'll turn in our hymn books to the psalm section. We're going to sing those words we just read. So Psalm 98, it's the first version, and we'll sing from verses 1 to 6 only. The verses 1 to 6, and again we'll stand as we usually do to worship. Let's all stand as we sing. Oh, sing a new song. Thank you. is the Lord. Well, we'll take time, we'll just unite our hearts together before the Lord in prayer. We'll ask God's blessing to rest upon us. Father, we thank thee for the return of the Lord's day. We thank thee for a real sense of thy presence this past while. We thank thee, Lord, for the workings of thy Spirit. And in many ways, though we've had participation, yet, Lord, we are spectators. We have beheld the works of God. We bow before thee and we thank thee that you are the God of all creation, worthy of honor and praise. And should you never do anything else for us, you're still God, worthy of glory and of adoration. We bow before thy thrice holy presence and worship thee. And we acknowledge, Lord, who thou art, God blessed forevermore, the true and the living God, the God of all creation, the one who created the world, the one who formed the very universe, called it into being by the word of thy power. We acknowledge thee as the true and the living God. Beside thee there is no God. There's none else beside thee. Thou art God alone, and we acknowledge thee. You're the God who fills all in all, and we recognize that in thee we live, we move, we have our being. Lord, in thy hand is our very breath. We realize, Lord, we live and we die according to the divine will of God. Nothing, not even the sparrow, falls to the ground without the Lord knowing it, without the will of God permitting it. We realize, Lord, you're sovereign, you're Adonai, you're the Lord of all creation, and you're the governor of the nations. We recognize thee as the ruler of the earth. We bow before thee, along with angels and archangels and saints made perfect in heaven, and the invisible and visible church on earth. We bow before the God of heaven, and we worship thee, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We thank thee, you're the God of salvation, the one who has revealed the way of redemption and salvation in the Word, the one who has, Lord, taught us not only that we're sinners, but we need a Savior, but you've pointed us to the Lamb of God, which have taken away our sin. We thank thee for thy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, for his love for each one of us, for the sacrifice that he made at Calvary, for that one great offering for sin forever. We thank thee, it is finished. There's nothing left to do. Lord, no works of man, no trappings of the church can add or take away from the finished work. It is enough that Jesus died, that he died for me. And Lord, we dare not add to the work. We must never take away from it by adding our own good works. We realize, Lord, that it is complete. It is sufficient. We thank thee that Christ has finished the work of salvation, and it was his peculiar and particular work to do. Lord, we had no part in it, neither angel nor man, nor devil or demon. We recognize that Christ alone is the Redeemer of God's elect, that Christ alone is the only Savior of the world. He's the only way to heaven, the only door through which by faith we enter in. He's the only one that we can come to thee, Father, through in repentance of our sin and find forgiveness because of his work at Calvary. We thank thee today, Lord Jesus Christ, for thy sorrow and sufferings endured on thy body. We thank thee for taking our place, loving us enough to come and to die for our sins at Calvary, to put those sins away that we might have peace with God. And then, Father, we thank thee he is risen from the dead. He's at thy right hand exalted. He's ever living now to intercede for us. It's a wonderful thought that Christ is now praying for me. Lord, what a comfort that is, that he is mindful of us. He hath remembered us. Any wonder we are exhorted in Psalms like the 98th to sing unto the Lord this new song. He has done wondrous things. His right arm and his right hand and holy arm hath gotten him the victory, and we have seen the salvation of our God, and we worship thee today. We thank thee, Father, for every temporal and spiritual blessing we enjoy. And Lord, we have sought to number them today already. We have been able, Lord, to, Lord, even count our many blessings and name them one by one. And it has surprised us what the Lord has actually done. And Lord, we often miss so much you've done for us. And we can say, like the hymn writer penned, Lord, for all the Lord hath done for me, I never will cease to praise him. And not unto us, O Lord, as the psalmist said, not unto us, but unto thy name we give glory and praise and honour. Thou alone art worthy, and it belongs to thee, and therefore we give it back to thee. We can take no praise. We're unprofitable servants, and even if we have done more than we think we have, then, Lord, even then, you've told us in the parable, we are to bow the head and beat the breast and say that we're unprofitable servants. We've only done our reasonable service. It's only what is expected of us, Lord. We can never really, in a sense, do more than what is expected. We realize, Lord, there's no amount of works could ever repay the debt we owe. We are to love thee and continually to love thee with all the heart. And Lord, that love will be manifested in the things we do. And Lord, even the lack of it in the things we don't do. And we pray, Lord, you will be with us again today as we would finish off the mission tonight, as we have the service this morning, the open air this afternoon, as the dedication, Lord, goes forward. We pray, Lord, that you will bless us richly as we have fellowship in the house with supper. Lord, we pray you'll crown this day with thy goodness and grace and mercy. Visit us again with salvation. Take of our thanks for an amazing, Lord, 3 weeks we have had in gospel campaigning. We thank thee for all the Lord hath been doing and all that will yet be done. And Lord, we bless thee for every token of thy love and mercy. We thank thee for the stirring of heart of the congregation. We thank thee for those who committed themselves fully to the gospel campaign, and for those who, Lord, as best they could, got out to the meetings, and we rejoice in that. Thank thee for saving precious, never dying souls. Thank thee for what God hath wrought. We thank thee for those who have come to Christ before the mission. We thank thee, Lord, for Maya and for Evie and for Richard. We thank thee for those who have come to saving faith during the mission. We thank thee for Elizabeth. We thank thee for William. We thank thee for Peter. We thank thee for hearing of others, O God, who have come through the influence of other gospel meetings to Christ. We thank thee, Lord, for Ivan Dempster and his wife, and for the many unsaved that have been in. We thank thee, Lord, for what you're doing. We think of those who left, Lord, the tent, Lord, with tears in their eyes, those who are under conviction and halting between two opinions. It may be that they've already got through to thee and been saved, but if not, may this be the day, may this be the very time, right now, not even tonight, but right now, they turn in repentance and seek the Lord and are saved by sovereign grace. We pray you'll bless every faithful effort that will continue in the gospel, those missions, Lord, that have gone into eternity, that are finishing and others commencing. We pray for the blessing of God upon the preaching of Christ, and that many will be the saved of the Lord. Continue with us, Lord, we pray, and we thank thee for the stirrings of heart among our young people. We thank thee for the boys and girls, the young people, the young adults. We thank thee, Lord, for the way they committed themselves to the meetings, and we pray that you'll bless them. We know that they, Lord, were a great encouragement to us, and we pray you'll encourage them. We pray you'll watch over our young people, that you'll keep them safe. We think of some who are sitting examinations, those who are under pressure, Lord, those who are seeking grades to get into this college or this university. Lord, we pray that whatever happens, they will accept the will of God, that you'll be with them. You'll help them in their study. You'll guide them in their future. You'll direct their path. Remember some who have decisions to make, whether to stay at home or go further afield. Remember those who have already got their place fixed and those who will have work experience. We commend our brother Callum to thee as he goes, Lord, to Dublin. We pray that you'll go with him and go before him. Keep him safe and watch over him and all of our young people. We commend them to God. And we pray, Lord, as those who have a vested interest in our children and in the youth of this congregation and elsewhere, that you will remember them and raise up a generation that'll be able to take their stand no matter where they are, whether they're in Israel or Babylon. We pray like Daniel and his friends, they'll be able to stand firm for the Lord and not compromise. So hear our prayer. Continue with us now. Take of our thanks too for answers to prayer. Thank you for those who were in hospital and are out again. Thank you for Sister Margaret. We pray your hand will be upon her for good, and Desmond and the wider family. We pray, Lord, for Gladys. We pray, Lord, for Norris. We ask, Lord, you remember these dear ones, and we commend them to God, and pray you'll comfort those who are at home recovering, Margaret McGee and many others too. Lord, hear our prayer and answer our cry. We humbly ask these things, giving thanks in the Saviour's precious and worthy name. Amen. Let's turn in our Bibles again, please, to the Psalm section. This is 28th Psalm this time, Psalm 28. This time we do have the author, the Psalm of David, and it is David's Psalm. We're never sure of the context, and I suppose sometimes it's good that we don't have a context. Somehow we would fix it And we would say it couldn't apply to me because it was specific to David, but it's certainly a time of David's trouble. It's David the aged, we believe. A David under pressure. David who has trouble in his home. And David who has trouble in his nation. And David who is overwhelmed by heartache and pain and suffering and sorrow. He's been blessed of God, there's no doubt. But the devil has attacked his home. The devil has come into the nation. And now David's overwhelmed. And he has to pour out his heart unto his God, as he has done so many times before. Here he is again in the place of prayer. So let's join him and let's sit with him and kneel before the Lord with him, and let's hear David's cry unto God. Psalm 28, a psalm of David. Unto thee will I cry, O Lord my rock. Be not silent to me, lest if thou be silent to me, I become like them that go down into the pit. Hear the voice of my supplications. When I cry unto thee, when I lift up my hands toward thy holy oracle or sanctuary, draw me not away with the wicked and with the workers of iniquity, which speak peace to their neighbors, but mischief is in their hearts. Give them according to their deeds and according to the wickedness of their endeavors. Give them after the work of their hands. Render to them their desert. Because they regard not the works of the Lord, nor the operation of his hands, he shall destroy them and not build them up. Blessed be the Lord, because he hath heard the voice of my supplications. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusted in him, and I am helped. Therefore my heart greatly rejoiceth, and with my song will I praise him. The Lord is their strength, and he is the saving strength of his anointed. Save thy people, and bless thine inheritance. Feed them also, and lift them up forever. Amen. We'll end our reading there. At the verse 9, we know the Lord will indeed bless the public reading of his own precious and infallible word. We're going to ask our clerk of session, Mr. Jackie Alistair, if he'll come forward, please. He's going to make some necessary announcements.
I do want to welcome you all out to our morning service this morning. Good to see you. And of course, it has been a busy couple of weeks that we've just come through, but a blessed couple of weeks. And it's good to return to the house of the Lord to give thanks and to worship him for what he has done. I do want to just say a word of thanks to all who have assisted over the last couple of weeks, even by your attendance. I don't know where to start. There have been so many who have helped out. There's, of course, the young folks in our congregation, and it's been very encouraging not to see them just out at the meetings, but to see them getting stuck into the work. Both when the tent was going up and coming down, and there was a real enthusiasm amongst our young folks, and I just want to express our appreciation to them. Then everyone else who helped in the physical aspects as the tent was going up and coming down. There was plenty of heavy machinery around. It was like an industrial site. And I would just express appreciation to those from our congregation who helped out in that regard. And of course, the stewards looked after the parking of the vehicles and looked after the site, the security that was undertaken. And not least, the ladies who looked after the catering. I think that perhaps turned out a bigger job than anticipated. But it was good to see the numbers of visitors out and the numbers in. And we do really appreciate those who provided the supper and who went the extra mile in that regard. Can I say as well a word of thanks to all those who have supported the mission financially. We, as you know, didn't specifically take up offerings, but there were a number of gifts that came in, and we appreciate that, and other monies placed in the offering baskets. Can I just say to you that in the 10 weeknights of the meetings in the tent, that's excluding the Sundays when the money just tended to go into the Sunday offering, but in the 10 weeknights, the total amounted to just a few pounds under £4,000. And that is something to be thankful for. And we do appreciate the support of you all in that regard. Now, the announcements, and they'll probably be long as well. Do remember that we're taking up our missionary offerings today after the service, the second Lord's Day of the month. And the offerings today will be going to the Missionary Council of our denomination. Then at 3 p.m., there is the open air down in Phillip Way. The bus will be leaving at 3:15 to head down there, weather permitting, and Phillip Way is the venue today. Then in the evening time, do of course remember the different time to normal. It is the last night of our gospel mission, and we've stuck to the time of 6:30 that we had in the tent. So at 6:30, meeting for that final mission, meeting of our gospel mission. If the choir could please meet at 6:15 for a quick last minute practice, and the choir will be singing at that mission meeting this evening. So do remember that, please. Then during the week, back to normal on Tuesday evening, our prayer meeting and time of Bible study at 8 p.m. Then on Friday, remember our seniors outing, for those who attend our seniors meeting, a meeting here at the church at 10 a.m., having some tea and scones before we head off, then leaving to head over to Hillsborough Castle at 11 a.m. From the church here. There will be opportunity there to see through the castle and so on, and then ending up later for our tea at
Brownlow House.
I couldn't think of the name of it there for a minute. So that'll be a full day and a day to look forward to. And we do encourage you, if you haven't returned your menu, we need to get that sorted today. I have mine here. It is completed, and I will be returning it after the service this morning. But if you'd remember to do that, there are still some blanks there in the hall of the church. And if you could, if you're able to go, fill up out the menu there and return it to Lorna or David today, if you can at all, please. Then Friday at 10 p.m., the men's prayer meeting. Next Lord's Day, our services, well, I was going to say at the usual times, and I suppose it is up to a point, but it is our Children's Day services. So a special day next Lord's Day. I should have said, of course, before I leave tonight's meeting, that there is supper afterwards, nearly overlooked that. So do remember that everyone will be invited to remain for supper after the mission meeting tonight. Next Lord's Day then, the Children's Day services, our brother Mr. Chris Killen is going to be the special speaker on Children's Day. In the morning time, if the boys and girls and young folks could come along at the normal time of 10:15 to make some preparations. And then in the evening time again, if they could be in the church for 6:30, please. And there will be the prize giving on Sunday evening, and there will be supper after that evening service as well, since it is Children's Day. We're going to be well fed over the next 2 or 3 weeks, because I think the Sunday after that is a family and friends night. So the supper next week, as I understand it, would be round to team one again. So do keep that in mind. And then on, again, in relation to the Sabbath school, Saturday the 24th of June, keep that date in mind. The Sunday school and church barbecue will be held here in the church grounds at 2:30 p.m. 2:30, Saturday the 24th of June. There'll be more details on that for next week. Right, let's look at the rest of my bits of paper now. Dealt with those, I think. Can I just say that next Lord's Day, as we've said, it's Children's Day, there'll be the two services at 11:30 and 7 p.m. No open air in the afternoon. That's the one break that we take over the summer between the beginning of May and the end of August, because of all that's going on and the Children's Day services and having to get the young folks home again afterwards. We take a break from the open air on that. This will be no open air next Lord's Day evening. Can I mention as well that, and some people have been asking me about this, but just all that's been going on, I haven't announced to get the boxes, the missionary boxes, in for Brother Robert. We usually bring them in around May time and then around November time again. So we're a bit overdue, but if you could bring the boxes in, if you have a missionary box, over the next couple of weeks, if you could bring those in, that would be most appreciated. Then can I mention as well, I think it may not have been mentioned yet, although it's been on the table, a little book by the Reverend Stanley Barnes, The Lord is My Shepherd. If you have a look at that, we have a supply of them there, and they cost just £7. So there is a list there in the porch, if you would add your name to that, if you take a book. And then finally, I think it's finally, Sunday the 25th, 2 weeks from today, will be a family and friends night again in the evening time, and our brother, Mr. Drew Murray, will be bringing a personal word of testimony at that special family and friends service. So do keep that in mind. We'll be having tea yet again, and if I can count, that'll bring us round to team two again. So do keep those things in mind, please. Thank you.
There you go. The announcements are getting as long as my sermons. It'll not be too long before Jackie be outshining the pastor here in the pulpit. But we do thank you, Jackie, for those announcements. Subject, as always, to the divine will of the Lord. It's a terrible thing to say. Could I add to them? but the Reverend Timothy Ormerod, I was about to say Nelson there. The Reverend Timothy Ormerod accepted the call to our congregation in Ballygowan. If I understand right, there will be the installation of our brother on the Friday the 30th of June. Is that right? It's Friday the 30th of June. We will keep that announcement before you. It's our local congregation, and we certainly want to encourage God's servant and trust that he'll be able to settle in early, and the Lord will undertake for him. And again, for the mission, and we concur with everything our clerk of session has said, and we just want to underscore how much we appreciate the help, the effort that you have put in, and it's been second to none. And if you had been there on Friday evening when that tent was coming down, I think it was record time. It was 2 hours. I said to our sister Sharon Patterson yesterday, I says, you know, it took 8 hours to put the tent up and they took it down in two. And she says, what were they doing then when they during those other 6 hours? But I tell us it's easier taken down. Within 2 hours, the entire field was empty. It was a sight to behold. I really mean that. And to see those young people, it really has encouraged us. And we're appreciative of the adults, and we probably would expect that from them. But it was the young ones that really stirred our hearts. I would tell you now, you would go a long, long way to find that replicated in any other congregation. I have to say that. I've never seen as many young ones and young adults participating, excited, and they're helping, doing what they could. And we commend everyone, but we want to single out our young people. And as your minister, I want to thank you personally and to encourage your heart. and to Megan Murray, he gets the gold star. He gets what is known as the eternal high-vis vest, and we will get one that fits you, not one that looks like an overcoat. But he was exceptional, and he was number one on site. He was the foreman. He was the supervisor. He was the boss, and there he was every single night. I don't think he missed any nights, and he was there working hard. And so were many, many other young people as well, and we appreciate that. To our media team, you've uploaded those messages, so the mission continues. And to Paul and the team, thank you sincerely. We mean that in the Saviour's precious name. For those who came to sing, and Brother Bruce, as he testified, and I acknowledge God's help for myself. So once again, we are grateful and thankful, and thank you so much for all that has happened. Tuesday night, God willing, is our prayer meeting, but we'll turn it into a night of thanksgiving and praise. It's only right that we take a night out and that we just gather as a congregation. So if you're able to come, we'll have a Bible reading, we'll have some time of praise and maybe sharing, and we'll have a time of thanksgiving and prayer. And I think it'll do us good. I think it's honourable to the Lord. So if you can join with us on Tuesday night, then please feel free to do that. Could I say that there was a watch found two Sunday mornings ago at the front door. It was at the front door. So I would suggest that it was communion morning, so folks would have stayed. So it was folks who had gone on and didn't were able to stay for communion. So there was a watch found. I still have it on my person. Not on my arm, in my hand here. And I'm not going to tell you whether it's male or female, whether it's a Rolex or some other, but if you can tell me, yes, it's my watch. And if you want to describe it in some detail to me, then we can be sure that it is yours. But we can trust you. If you say I lost a watch, we'll give it to you anyway. The Lord knows. But if you have lost a watch and you don't know where it's gone, well, do see us today at the door and we'll be able to return your property to you. 623, before we come to the preaching of God's word. 623, God is here and that to bless us. We'll sing the first and the second verses only. Verses 1 and 2 of 623, please. Amen. Let's turn again in our Bibles to the 28th Psalm. Let's just keep our Bibles open before us. Again, we'll ask help of God in the hearing and in the ministry of his word. Let us all pray. O God, our gracious and our eternal loving Heavenly Father, it is with thanksgiving that we enter into thy courts and into thy most holy and sacred, righteous and just presence. We bow before thee in acknowledgement of thy goodness and grace. Unworthy, unworthy, and we acknowledge it. But yet, Lord, thou hast been so good to us. Lord, we're humbled, we're overwhelmed at the love and mercy and goodness of God. And Lord, we just lift our Ebenezer and we say, hitherto hath the Lord helped us. It augurs well for the future, for we know you're building your church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And Lord, we ask now you'll be with us in the closing moments of our morning and afternoon worship. We pray, Lord, you'll be with us in the meditation upon the word. May the word comfort, encourage, and strengthen. May it uplift and bless. So to this end, pour out of thy spirit. As we've been singing, we know you're here. We feel thy presence. And let the shower of blessing fall, for we are waiting and expecting, and revive the hearts of all. Hear our cry just now, and meet with us at the point of our need. To this end, Father, the preaching forth of thy holy word, give to me the anointing and the infilling of thy spirit. Give to me, Lord, that help from above. Show mercy, we pray. And God, grant that you will be with us in all things today, not only this afternoon. Remember, O God, in the open air, we pray for the dedication of Paul and Ashley's little boy. We pray for the final message in the gospel mission, and then the supper afterward. Lord, hear our cry and help us today. Father, fill me now with thy Holy Spirit in wisdom and with power, and help me to handle the word of life. I ask these things now, believing with thanksgiving in Jesus' precious name. And the people of God said, Amen. You know, this short psalm was probably written during the time of a national crisis. We do believe it is David, the aged, an individual who has wrestled with God, who has battled for Jehovah, who has passed through some very trying times and realizes that he's just human, he's fickle, and even past experiences don't always help in times of difficulty. But we do believe it was written during David's lifetime of the very rebellion of Absalom. Whenever there was civil strife in his own home, when his son rebelled against him, took the crown from him, and David fled and was a fugitive, and he was in danger again of his life. It seems to be at every turn, David could not take a step, but he was facing an enemy. He couldn't move without someone coming after him. During the persecution of Saul, he had a little respite when he came to the throne. But even then, many of the tribes, I think it was 7 years before the rest of the tribes actually came under the kingship of David as the rightful king over Israel. But we do believe it was that heartbreaking time whenever Absalom rebelled against his father and took the people away and stole away their hearts and left David destitute of everything essential for life and living. He couldn't even get to the house of God. He couldn't worship in the tabernacle. He couldn't offer his offerings. He couldn't meet with God. He was a fugitive fleeing, and very few were alongside David. They were afraid of Absalom. So he had civil strife in the nation, and he had literally war in his own home. And I believe the language of verses 4 and 5 place this psalm among what is known as the imprecatory psalms. What do we mean by that? They're psalms that call judgment from heaven down to earth. They're what is known as imprecatory psalms. And those that are critics of the Old Testament especially, those in the media, they love to go to psalms like this. And they say, what sort of God have you got? The psalmist calls down vengeance upon the inhabitants of the earth. These are little mirror images, by the way, of what's actually going to happen on this earth when these psalms literally will be fulfilled, and they have a prophetic context as well as an historical and practical. But there's no doubt they are. This psalm, anyway, is along with many others called the imprecatory psalms. Look at verse 4. David says, give them, that's the wicked, that's the heathen, the rejectors of God, the haters of God, give them according to their deeds. How's that unfair? How's that unjust? Give them according to their wickedness and their sin. Look what it says there. It goes on to actually say that. According to the wickedness of their endeavors, give them after the work of their hands. Render to them their desert. Because, look at verse 5, they regard not the works of the Lord. They're not going to turn to you. They're not going to repent. They're not going to help the righteous. It says they regard not the works of the Lord, nor the operation of his hands. He shall destroy them and not build them up. So there's no hope for these individuals. But I want to tell you something. And we hear so much criticism of these imprecatory psalms. Such imprecations are never vindictive. It is not jealous rage. It is not vindictive anger. It is not God who is out of control the way human beings lash out whenever they are provoked. This is a God who is long-suffering, a God who is patient with the wicked, a God who tolerates the sin of the world, a God who is patient with legislation of governments, a God who does not sit idly by, but observes, and it must grieve the Lord. But how long-suffering and patient he is. But on this occasion, David now calls for God to send judgment upon the wicked, because there's no hope for them now. They have gone too far. And David cries under inspiration, by leading of the Spirit of God, to deal with wicked men who has overthrown the rightful government of God, who have set in place a despot, an individual who has stolen the heart of the people, and then there was wickedness in the land. And David, during his time, was like the Lord. He was patient with the wicked. There were people that David could have destroyed and put to death, and he didn't. I think Joab was one of them. A so-called ally of the king, his military general, that's right, who fought many a battle. But I want to tell you something, there was no love lost. If you study your Bible, there was no love lost between Joab and King David. In fact, you could preach a message, because Joab's a type of the rebellious sinner against the king. And Joab was a man who had no respect for David. In fact, Joab was a very wicked individual. And no one knows the people he killed. This man would have killed more than we could ever imagine. Hundreds of thousands of individuals he'd done to death. Some he never should have killed. Certainly Abner was one of them. He was a bloody man in every sense of the word. A rebel. And him and David never got on, even though he was his military general. There was no love lost, and Joab certainly was one of those men that David could have put to death, and he didn't. How long-suffering. But it comes a point in time, under inspiration, that the Spirit of God pours out his judgment upon nations and upon individuals. But these judgments are never vindictive, and they're never motivated by personal prejudice neither. Rather, they're inspired by the Spirit of God to give us all a very solemn warning of God's hatred of wickedness and God's hatred of sin. But the great burden of David's heart in the psalm was not necessarily the wicked. He left them to the Lord. But it was the vexing behavior of his so-called friends. Yes, the wicked around him. And he asked the Lord, despite what's going on in the land, that the Lord would preserve him, the Lord would keep him, the Lord would look after him, the Lord would protect him from the attacks of the enemy. It's a bit like a parent who's praying for their children, and they're about to enter in perhaps to a phase in life that is dangerous. They're going to big school, and you feel that they're just your little child, and here they are, and they're starting secondary school, but when you look at them, there they are playing maybe with their toys. Maybe that's not the case with some, and maybe they're a bit more mature than that. And you see them, and they go to bed at night, and they have their little teddy bear, and they go to bed at night, and they have their little blanket, and so on. I remember going to a youth camp, and there were 74 young people, and there was a bit of dispute between two young people, and it was this, that both of them had bought their parents' aftershave on the boat, and one of them had lost it, and the other one said he lost his and he took mine. I come in to deal with the dispute. I searched the room for the aftershave in case it was lost. I says, have you searched everywhere? I opened the suitcase, the zip. I lifted it up, and what was in the middle of it? Rupert the bear. And all I could see was this. I shoved it closed, and I thought, if any of those older ones see Rupert, this young fella is in for it. First of all, Rupert will be hanging by the ear or the neck from the ceiling, swinging. He'd be ripped open with a knife. Nah, it's not that bad. He'd be the stuffing hanging out of him, and he'd be hanging from the ceiling by his ear, and that young fella gets some stick. But you know something? It touched my heart, really touched my heart, because the mum had put in the little comforter. And those of us who are parents, and we know all about that, we know all about that. They put in the comforter. And we went on holidays, and maybe not so much now, but our boys brought all their comforters. I used to set their rucksack on their back. Sometimes they didn't know it, The little teddy bear's head was hanging outside the rucksack so that everybody could see in the airport. What a bad parent I am. But you know something? I want to tell you something. That no matter what goes on in your life or mine, we care for our children. And when they go somewhere and they're doing something, we're fearful. We're anxious. And that's like David's heart here. He's anxious for himself. He's concerned for the rest of the family members. It's a dangerous world and a damaged world and a defiled world we're living in because of sin. And therefore he prays to God not only for himself, but his friends and his rest of his family that didn't rebel with Absalom, who were going maybe to be put to death by Absalom if they remained in the kingdom or if they didn't submit to him and do his evil deeds. I want to tell you, my friends, it's a fitting psalm for today's generation when we consider the anti-Christian trends in society, when we think of the boldness and the defiance of the ungodly sinner in their rage against God and against his Christ, when we think of the rejection of the Word of God and the departure there is from truth, I want to tell you something. When there is this digression away from everything that's morally good, this is a good psalm to read, to pray over, and to meditate upon. For the child of God, we're living in such days. We're in wicked and terrible times, but yet there's comfort for you today in the 28th psalm. And I just want to look at it briefly with you here this morning, and I will finish it. Don't you worry, I will finish it. I will not take it on to another time. I want you to notice, first of all, very simply, look at verse 7, if we were to take that as our text. Verse 7, look what it says there in the verse 7. Maybe you've memorized this. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusted in him and I am helped. Therefore my heart greatly rejoiceth, and with my song will I praise him. Remember the context in which those words were spoken. I've given to you the very context in which those words were spoken. I say to you this, that first of all, David says, the Lord is my strength. Notice there in verse 7, the Lord is my strength. And then elsewhere in the psalm, he's the saving strength of his anointed, of his people. The thought being is this, that the Lord is the mighty, powerful, strong one. That's what's really implied here. The Lord is my powerful. He's my mighty. He's my strong one. He's my defense. That's what he is. He gives me power. He gives me strength. He puts courage into my heart. He brings fortitude to my mind. It gives me iron in my soul. The Lord is my strength. Again, David said in the 27th Psalm, the Lord is my light and my salvation. The Lord is the strength of my life. Oftentimes you hear people say this, and especially when they're going through a time of grief, when they've lost a loved one, we have often heard them say this, I just don't know where I got the strength from to get through that. I want to tell you where. The Lord is your strength. He's your keeper. He's the one who is the mighty one, the strong one, the powerful one, who helps you, keeps you, and strengthens you. And there's so much implied in that, by the way. Not just physical strength, moral courage, fortitude of mind, resolve, determination, strength of character, belief, conviction. It's all contained in that little phrase, the Lord is my strength. Why would we leave the Lord and look to something else? It's weakness. Look to yourself and your friends as weakness. Look to the counselors and many other things as a form of weakness. Why we get help from others, there's no doubt about that. And God uses others. That's not our main port of call. That's what I'm saying. The Lord is. That's what he is. Just as we would say the Lord is good and the Lord is great and the Lord is holy. That's what he is. The Lord is strength to me. That's what he is to me. Strength. Why do I need something else? Why do I need a prop? Why do I need other supports? And while things can be used of God, I'm very careful in what I'm saying, yet ultimately it's the Lord who is my strength. David didn't say, Egypt will be my strength, he'll come and help me. He didn't say, all those other countries that I didn't destroy and I permitted to live, they'll come and help me. All those that are disgruntled against Absalom will come and help me. My friends will rally round me. He didn't say that. He says, the Lord will strengthen me. The Lord will help me. The Lord will protect me. The Lord will see through me through this difficulty. So the Lord is the strength of my life. As such then, when you think of it, In the context of the psalm, he's what is known as the unshakable one. You notice in verse 1 what it says. Verse 1 actually gives us that. Look what it says in verse 1, Psalm 28. Unto thee will I cry, O Lord, my rock. He is the unshakable one. That's why he is David's strength. He literally is the one who will never be moved. Our God is rock-like. In other words, he's a foundation, a sure foundation upon which we can stand. The unchangeable, the unshakable nature of our God and his character. I am the Lord, I change not. Your friends will let you down. They will. They disappoint you. And you may have friendships for years, and all of a sudden, when it comes to a time of crisis, when you expect some support and encouragement and comfort, they're not there. They've abandoned you. Don't put your trust in man. Don't do it. Even your best friends, listen to me, your best friends will let you down. And I say this with respect to the calling of God to ministry. Even the pastor, the minister will disappoint and he'll let you down. But the Lord will not. He's what is known as the unshakable one. That's why he can say the Lord is my strength. In other words, he's my rock. We often hear people say, you know, that little child of mine's my rock. Or we've heard even some men say of their wives, she's my rock, you know. I don't know what I would do without her. And we understand in the human context what that means. And we actually appreciate that. And I can say in our home of my wife, she's the rock. There's no doubt. She's the hub. And we would miss if she wasn't there. But I will say this, it's the Lord who's our rock. And if we can say that of a human being and find it to be true and get comfort from it, how much more of your God, that he is your rock. You stand on him. He's unshakable. Isn't that beautiful? You see, the Bible speaks about those things that can be shaken. This world can be shaken. Earthquakes can shake this world. I want to tell you, there are things can shake the economy, the crash, the global market, the banks. All of these things can shake the earth in its money systems. All of those things can crumble and fall. We have seen it. The crash of the market globally. But the Lord says, I am the Lord, I change not. Jesus Christ the same yesterday and today and forever. All may change, Jesus never, glory to his name. And you know, brethren and sisters, the world around us is crumbling morally and spiritually. Everything we hold dear, the very foundations are being shaken by a godless, atheistic, humanistic, socialist world in which we live. But isn't it good to know that we have foundations that can never be destroyed? I could preach now, right now, for another hour on foundations that cannot be destroyed, but I'm not going to do that. But I could. And I know you would never put me to the test. It's racing in my mind now, those things that cannot be shaken. I'll just say them to you. I'll not preach on them. But I want to tell you, God's throne reigns. God has never relinquished his power. He's the unshakable one. Governments can legislate, but they'll never put God out of this world. They will never dethrone the Lord. They will never overrule his authority. God's throne reigns in this earth. Now, are you glad you're on the right side of things if you're saved? His church remains. I will build my church. What did Jesus say? And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Oh, listen, there'll be the Cains who'll slay the Abel. Of course, there'll be the mockers who'll laugh at the Noahs. Of course, there'll be the Absaloms who rebel against the Davids. Of course, there will be the Judases that betray the Savior. Of course, there will be individuals like rulers like Herod and Pilate and many others who will persecute the church and will do down the believer. But I want to tell you something. God is adding to his church. Christ is saving souls right now. The church is growing. Did you know that? The church is being built. Lively stones are being added in right now. And just because we can't see it as much here in this side of the pond, I want to tell you, across the world, the Lord is calling out a people. Right now, if Christ was only to show you, there could be literally hundreds of thousands in the last hour that have come to saving faith in Christ. I want to tell you, heaven's being populated and hell is being diminished. I want to tell you that. Christ is saving, and he'll build his church. I said I wouldn't preach, so I better not. But the throne of God reigns. The church of Christ remains. And I want to tell you, his word reassures. That word is not outdated. That word is not something that is not up to date. They tell us that it's out of date, it's a dinosaur, and it's a fossil, and you should just leave it where it is and not bring it into the modern world. I want to tell you, the word of God reassures. And listen, the Christ of God redeems and so on. We are eternally secure in the unshakable one. And the Lord is my strength. That strengthens your faith. Listen, he's the unfailing one. Notice what it says there in verse 1 and 2. Let me read it to you. Verses 1 and 2. Take your Bible and look at it. Unto thee will I cry, O Lord my rock. Be not silent to me. Lest if thou be silent to me, I become like them that go down into the pit. That is, God never speaks to those in hell. That's what that means. Hear the voice, verse 2, of my supplication when I cry unto thee, when I lift up my hands toward thy holy sanctuary or oracle. Verses 1 and 2, he is the unfailing one. Why? Look at verse 6, that's why. Look what it says. Blessed be the Lord, because he hath heard the voice of my supplications. In verses 1 and 2, David cries, hear my cry. It's a desperate cry to the Lord. And literally it means to holler. It means to shout out. If you were literally reading this properly from the Hebrew language, you would come to that word cry, and you would shout it out as loud as you could, because it means to literally scream out in desperation. Lord, hear my cry. Answer me. And then he says, be not silent to me. And the unfailing one hears his prayer, answers his cry. And David says, blessed be the Lord. I want to tell you something. If David wrote this psalm in 20 minutes, between verses 1 and 5, let's say he had taken 10 minutes. Well, in 10 minutes' time, the Lord had answered his prayer. And either it was an assurance in his heart, because I believe that's what it was, because we know it took a long time for Absalom to be dethroned. But David got a reassurance in prayer that the unfailing one will not let him down. And therefore, the eye of faith could see the victory, and then says, blessed be the Lord, for he hath heard. Within 10 minutes of meeting with God, I suggest to you that David got an answer right away from God. There was no waiting time on this occasion. Oft times he said, did he not say at the end of Psalm 27, wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. But on this occasion, there was no waiting time. He prayed, and within 10 minutes, I suggest to you, of writing those first 5 verses. I don't believe David took 2 days to write a psalm. There's some psalms, if you take Psalms 3, 4, and 5, they're what is known as the evening, morning, and evening psalms. If you look at it, there are psalms that were written when David was a fugitive, and he wrote one in the evening before he went to bed. He got up in the morning and he wrote another one, and then in the evening he wrote another. I think it's Psalms 3, 4, and 5 are what is known as the evening, the morning, and the evening psalms. Within a 24-hour period, David had written 3 psalms. And I say to you, I suggest to you, that within 10 minutes of praying, crying to God, God immediately heard his prayer. It wasn't so for Daniel. 21 days before Daniel got an even answer to his prayer, he wrestled for 21 days, 3 weeks. And not one answer from God, and no reassurance. And we know what happened. Satan, the prince of Persia, wrestled with Michael, the archangel, in the heavens. With an angel that was sent with an answer. Do you know what happened? They had to call for Michael to contend with the devil in the air, because he's the power of the prince of the power of the air. He's the god of this world. And he hindered an angel leaving heaven to give an answer to and comfort Daniel in Babylon. And as a direct result of that, Michael had to come, the archangel, stronger, more powerful angel, and had to fight in the air during those 21 days. And eventually, word got through, and the devil couldn't stop the answer coming. And after 21 days, God touched Daniel, lifted him up, and encouraged his heart. You should read that in the book of Daniel. It's a remarkable incident. But on this occasion, he got an instant answer. I tell you, child of God, no matter your problem or difficulty, seek the Lord now and get the assurance. Even though it may come later on, at least get the assurance, God has heard me. He'll deal with this. This is going to be sorted. That's basically what David did. So we can pray, we can cry, we can call. And the wonderful thing is we have the unfailing one. God hears. And he's the unconquerable one. Verses 4 and 5, which we did read. And it is what is known as the imprecatory psalm. He's the unconquerable one. Because David says to God to deal with the wicked. You see, the wicked are trying to overthrow God. But David recognizes it's impossible. It cannot be overthrown. He cannot be conquered. And so David, in praying God would judge, acknowledges God as the unconquerable one. You couldn't tell someone who's weak and insignificant to deal with someone who's powerful and mighty. It'll not happen. But you can tell someone who has the power to destroy them who think they have the authority and power to destroy God. And so that's what we find here. The Lord is my strength because he is, isn't he? He is what is known as the unfailing one. I want to tell you something. He is the unconquerable one. And he is the unshakable one. Any wonder David says, the Lord is my strength. In other words, if God be for you, who can be against you, child of God? Notice secondly and very quickly, the Lord is not only my strength, but David says in verse 7, the Lord is my shield. That's a beautiful statement. Whether it's a little small shield, I think whenever Paul was standing beside the guard in Rome, and he wrote Ephesians, and he saw the centurion, and he copied the centurion's armor, and he said, put on the helmet of salvation, and then put on the belt of truth, and the breastplate of righteousness. He was looking at a Roman soldier, and he says, in your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, and have on the sword of the Spirit, and then he says, the shield of faith. I don't believe it was the large shield that covered the whole body. I believe it was the little small shield. It's what is known as the buckler. If you read that in the Old Testament in the Psalms, it speaks about shield and buckler. One's the large shield. It's massive. And what you do is you can put it over your head like that, and you can literally cover at least 20 men with their shields up at the sides and at the front. But the little small shield was for close combat. Whenever you're engaging the enemy face to face, you had the small shield in your hand and the sword, depending what hand you fought with. The right hand for me and the left hand with the shield. It was really, as Paul says, to quench the fiery darts of the devil, as well as that. But it doesn't matter. It represents both shields. It means all-round protection. Whether it's close combat or whether it's combat at a distance, it doesn't matter. Whatever the devil throws at you, whether from a distance or whether the devil throws it at you at close range. And the words could be like this: the world attacks you and then your family come closer and they attack you. The world attacks you and then your friends turn on you. That's the kind of shield you'll use. When the world attacks you, you'll use the large shield. When your friends and your family that are close to you attack you, and your work colleagues attack you, and they're close to you and they're in your face, that's the small shield. That's the dagger as well that you use in the sword of the Spirit. A soldier in Bible times never went to battle without a shield. In fact, a sword was not much use without a shield. The shield mentioned, as I told you, is either the buckler, and I believe it is, rather opposed to the all-round larger shield, but it doesn't matter because it means all-round protection. Either way, the main thought is this: the Lord is my shield. In other words, it's as if his shadow just falls over me and covers me and surrounds me. And in front of me is the Lord. In front of me is the Lord. Do you know, whenever I was young, I'm sure you got the same. Well, maybe you didn't move in the circles that I did. But there were things went on, and there were boys who were bullies. And they would have picked on young fellas and wee boys. And they would have shown off, and they would have punched them, and they would have kicked them, and they would have shoved them, and they would have threw them down, and they mocked them and laughed at them. And there were dirty bullies. And oft times you used to say, I'd get my da for you. My boys never said that because they knew I couldn't help them. I get my da for you. You see, I said to myself, but better saying I'll get my ma. She would do more harm than the da. But then they used to say, I get my big brother for you. And then there were some boys who we knew their big brothers, and they were bad articles. And if these boys were picked on, they say, I'm going to get my big brother for you. And when they came, those other fellas ran. I want to tell you something. There's the enemy coming against you, an easy target. And they're bullying you. That's right, child of God. They're mocking, they're laughing, they're shoving, they're kicking, they're slapping, they're spinning. And all their venom, it's all there. I want to tell you something. See, at that time, the Lord comes by. And the Lord becomes your shield. He stands in front of you. The shield is an actual person. It's an actual person. And as if his shadow covers you. That's your shield, the shadow of the Lord. No one can penetrate. There's nothing in this world can harm the child of God under the shadow of the Almighty, dwelling there with the Lord in front of them, the Lord at the side of them, the shadow at the back of them, all-round protection. That's what it is. Facing the enemy with the Lord with you. You're unconquerable. I want to tell you, the Lord protects me from harm and danger. He covers my defenseless head in battle, as Wesley in his great hymn said. He surrounds me with his love and his presence. He keeps me safe from the destructive power of sin in my own heart and Satan in the world. He's a wall of fire round about me. He's a hedge around me. He's a shield from the attacks of the enemy. The hymn writer put it like this: a sovereign protector I have, unseen yet forever at hand, unchangeably faithful to save, almighty to rule and command. He smiles and my comforts abound. His grace as the dew shall descend, and walls of salvation surround the soul that he delights to defend. Now there is a hedge of blood around you. There is a wall of fire around you. I want to tell you something, child of God. Now you listen to me. This is scriptural. You can't see it, but it's actually true right now. In this church building, there are hundreds of thousands of angels. That's right. You can't see them. They're present right here. In fact, I want to tell you something. One thing the angels look at in a congregation like this, will I tell you what they're looking at as well? The ladies with the head covering. Did you know that? They behold that the glory of man and worship is covered. Angels are present in this building. They're actually here surrounding this very building. I want to tell you that right now. You can't see them. The days of Elisha, he said to the Lord, open his eyes, and his servant saw the heavenly host. They're here. Where the church meets, holy angels are present. And if you could see the warfare and the battle that's going on between the forces of darkness and holy angels at this time, it would shock you. But they're here. Single angels watch over us. I want to tell you something. They're never made visible and they never will. You know why? Because we would worship them rather than the Lord. That's why the Lord never makes them visible and never will. Angel worship is forbidden. Not one angel is worthy of worship. They worship God as we do. But they're here. And I want to tell you something. They're ministers of God sent to them who are the redeemed of the Lord, and they're with us. And Christ is with us with the heavenly host. The captain of those armies of heaven is Christ. And we're on the Lord's side. We're battling along with the Lord. And we're on the victory side. I want to tell you something. The Lord is my keeper. The Lord is my shade upon my right hand. The sun therefore shall not smite me by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve me from all evil. He shall preserve my soul. The Lord shall preserve my going out and coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. And beloved, listen to me. Because the Lord is our defense, he's our shield, he's our protector, who or what can harm us? If God be for us, who can be against us? Any wonder David said, my heart trusteth in him, and I am helped. Take heart, child of God. The Lord is on thy side. Notice thirdly and finally, the Lord is not only his strength and shield, but look what he says there, and I like this. It says, the Lord is my song. You know, some people in this world, and they've nothing to sing about. They have nothing to sing about. Unless you're a Manchester City fan, you might have a little thing to sing about. Our sister Anne White will be rejoicing today in that sense. But David is saying is this, the Lord is the joy and he's the rejoicing of my heart. The Lord has made me glad. Is that a wonderful thing? It's a wonderful thing to say the Lord hath made me glad. You see, when the Lord makes you glad, I'm telling you now, not even the thought of making money could ever add to that. Not even the thought of going away on holiday and you're all excited could ever compare to that. Not the greatest joys on earth could ever match or comparable. I wonder, when was the last time? And I believe in recent days it's happened for you. Maybe some haven't. When was the last time you were able to say, the Lord has made me glad? I could relate to you dozens of times last week, the week before, week of prayer, and before that. I can truthfully come out of meetings in people's houses and say, and even a quiet time, and literally say that, the Lord is my song. He's made me glad. You see, Christ makes us glad. His word makes us joyful. His presence gives us contentment. His love makes us happy. Listen, child of God, as I close, you have a body that's out of the grave. Is that not something to be glad about? You have food on your table. You have a roof over your head. You have clothes upon your back. You have the forgiveness of all your sins. You have peace with God. You have everlasting life. You've got a home in heaven. I want to tell you something. You have Christ as your Savior, God as your Father, the Holy Spirit as your Comforter. You have the Word of God to help and to bless. I want to tell you, you have a right to shout and sing. And sometimes we are too conservative and maybe too morbid, and we don't rejoice in the Lord enough, and we don't show that our faces are saved as well as our soul. I want to tell you, we're not into charismatic nonsense, but I do believe the children of God have a right to shout and sing. There's nothing wrong with rejoicing in the Lord and being happy in God. Happy are the people that have the God of Jacob as their refuge. Happy or blessed are the people who have the Lord as their God. We have a right to shout and sing. And listen, no discouragement, no devil or demon, no joyless Christian, no discouraging believer should ever stop you rejoicing in your God. Can I tell you of a godly, saintly old lady? She's dead now, obviously. She attended a church, and in that church, she was a believer, and she rejoiced in the Lord, but it was a dead church. She shouldn't really have been in it. It was a dead church, and it never rejoiced in the Lord because most of them were not saved, and even the minister, they had nothing to rejoice in, nothing to be glad about, but she did, and every Sunday they became sick, sore, and tired of her. She came in, and she was praising the Lord, and she was shouting hallelujah, and she was shouting glory, and she was shouting amen, and they continually told her she must be quiet in church. She's not allowed to speak, and she must stop this nonsense in church. Amen, hallelujah, glory, all that nonsense, stop it all. And she refused. So she came in, and they were singing. They read the word, she shouted even louder. And they had enough. And four strong men grabbed her and says, you're leaving. And on the way out, she still was praising God. But she said this, I quote, she says, praise God. Jesus rode in to Jerusalem on a donkey, and I'm being carried out of church by four of them. She was not going to be silenced. She was not going to be told by dead, joyless Christians that she shouldn't praise the Lord. Now, we don't believe in the charismatic nonsense we get today. Billy Bray was a hardened, drunken Cornish tin miner, and one day the Lord Jesus Christ saved his precious soul. Ever since that day, he never ceased to sing and praise the Lord. Everywhere he went, he would boldly shout, hallelujah, praise the Lord. One of Billy Bray's favorite sayings was this. He used whenever people were reticent of him praising and they didn't want to join with him. Whenever those complained about his enthusiastic singing and shouting for the Lord, he said this, if you were to put me in a barrel and you were to shut the lid on it, I would shout glory and hallelujah and praise the Lord through the bunghole. He wasn't going to be silenced. I want to tell you, child of God, even this past while, the Lord has been good to us. The Lord has been kind and generous and merciful. The Lord has done great things for us. We have a right to shout and sing. We must say, praise God, for the Lord is not only my strength, and he has been our strength. He's not only our shield. God protected us even in the mission. But he is our song. He has made us glad. Therefore, child of God, sometimes we stir you up to serve. Sometimes we stir you up, perhaps, to work. Sometimes we stir you up to pray. Sometimes we stir you up to witness. Sometimes we preach and stir you up to holy living. Well, today, I want to stir you up to praise, to worship, and to sing. Why don't you get the hymn book out today and sing unto the Lord? I heard my neighbour practising with his guitar. Hope he's not listening because it was dreadful. And he was singing, although he's a good singer, but he certainly needs to work at the guitar. And I listened to him and I thought, would I be out the back strumming badly on a guitar and singing, and the neighbours hear me sing, "Oh, the children of the Lord." I was just about to burst into song there for you, and I feel like singing. But get the hymn book out, sing. Lift your heart today. If you haven't got a hymn book or a course book, you've got the memory. Just start singing. Whatever it is, praise the Lord today. And don't let dead, joyless Christians put you off. Father in heaven, we thank thee for our Saviour. We thank thee that the joy of the Lord is our strength. And Lord, we bless thee that we have a right to shout and sing. The Lord is good. The Lord is great. We thank thee for saving our souls, Lord. We thank thee for everything you've done. And we rejoice in thee because the Lord is my strength. The Lord is my shield. The Lord is my song. He's my salvation. And the Lord is everything to me. Praise his name. Father, take up our thanks and bless us now in Jesus' precious name. And the people of God said, amen. And they shouted.
Amen.
Okay. You need a bit of practice on that one. No, I'm only joking. Thank you.